the foreshadowing of Comet Ison and the sun, solar instability continues to be intense, very intense, even though I'm not really particularly looking for it. It just suddenly, it's just staring me right in the face. I said, holy cow. So, solar instability has always been very high concern when it comes to subtle information, subtle foreshadowing, warnings, etc. A lot of people have received subtle warnings about solar instability, and here comes the comet Ison coming in. So, and yet there's other stuff going on too. It's a very large situation right now. There's a lot on our plate. There's also been those giving out dates, very near dates, so to speak, about stuff really happening soon. Okay, that's also on our plate. But there's even more, a lot more on our plate. You might say that we're overloaded. Lately, I've been having numerical synchronicities coming up that are simply mind-boggling, inexplicable. The number 33 continues to come up in the most amazing ways. I wake up every morning at 3:30 in the morning. I think it's morning. I look at my watch. It's always 3:30. I said, what in the world's going on? I'm walking along the Golden Gate Bridge. In the fog, it's so dense, I'm looking for some security. Suddenly there's this upright, huge steel upright, and on the number on it, stamped in it, 33. Today, I decide I have to start exercising because I'm terribly out of shape. So I push myself out to go golfing. They say, take cart number 33 to me. It goes on and on and on with 33. Just incredible stuff is happening right now. As a matter of fact, what is happening right now is just mind-blowing, actually. And I speak about these things not because it's personal stuff with me, but it's actually, these are all archetypes. This is what's happening. The whole planet is immersed in all sorts of archetypes that are impacting everybody on the planet. I was warned today, I got tipped off today about a very, very insidious attack on me that was going to happen today, and it did. And when I was tipped off, I was warned, I prepared, I asked the Holy Spirit for protection, and I managed to get through it. But it was, wow. The things that happen, you know, truth is stranger than fiction, to tell you the truth. It is, I mean, what goes on in this bizarre swamp that we call existence is just too weird, you know, to recount. No, you know, just, if you tell people what happens, people just say, you're making that up or something. It's not possible. But if you're in touch with your own life, with the Holy Spirit, you become aware of how the ego is tempting to manipulate you and trying to keep you bound to its plan of salvation, which is really its plan of damnation. And it wants to turn everybody towards what's called the flesh, the animal nature, the creatureness, okay, and away from the Holy Spirit. And it is incredibly industrious at this, and very slick and very devious, and it times its actions psychically so incredible. And I had the situation today that was just amazing. And I feel like I escaped it. I escaped it, but it could have been disastrous for me, actually. And nobody, it was such a quote-unquote innocent thing. But I had been tipped off and warned about it ahead of time. I actually talked to somebody. I said, hey, a acquaintance, a friend that I've been, you know, friendly to, and they said something very odd, and it caught my attention, and the way he looked, it was like, I said, something's going on here. And I immediately got this sense of, uh-oh, I'm in big trouble today. Something is being planned. And it happened. It happened. The tip-off was correct. It was accurate. And because I paid attention to it, I began to sort things out in my mind and create sort of a buffer to the whole situation. So when it did happen, I was able to just sidestep it. I was able to sidestep it. But it was, you know, one of the most vicious psychic assaults that you could possibly have happen to you. And nobody on the surface would have seen it that way at all. But I was very much aware. In hindsight, you know, it happened so fast and unexpectedly. And fortunately, I had already had a buffer and I had sidestepped it. But then looking back, I said, wow. That was, the ego really planned that one out very carefully. And, it's amazing. It's amazing how vicious the ego is. And how terrible this world really is. The ego wants to turn us towards the external world. That, as I have said, most of us try to make this world beautiful. I have certainly have, and taking pictures and videos and say, oh, look how beautiful it is. Because we think, oh, if this world's our home, we better learn to love it, right? So of course we're trying to take pictures and say, oh, look how beautiful it is, you know, but it's not our home, and it's not lovable. Impermanence, death, this dance of impermanence, death is not lovable. But the ego's plan is to try and keep us attracted to the external, this externalness, the flesh, materiality, instead of going within. Jesus said the kingdom of heaven is within, not within the body, but within the mind of spirit, not external, not projected as matter is projected. It's not in matter, it's within the spiritual realm. Now when Jesus washed the feet of the disciples, the apostles, and what was he doing? You know, there's been a lot of talk about the Pope washing the feet of all these people, and people say, oh, look how, what a great servant, etc. Now, that's a misinterpretation. When Jesus washed the feet of the disciples, what was he doing? He was washing the world away from them, because what is your contact with the world? Your feet touching the ground and the dust on their, they wore sandals, the dust, the dirt, the dust on their feet. He was washing the world away from them, off of them. That's what it really symbolized, is saying this world is not your home. I am using my spiritual grace to rid you, free you of the earth, this planet, externalization, okay, and directing you back to the kingdom of heaven, which is the spiritual realm, the true spiritual realm, which is not matter. It's not matter energy. It's essence and idea. That's the real symbology of it. That wasn't just some kind of Jesus the Good Samaritan. All this talk about Jesus as a social justice Good Samaritan, all that stuff is such a misdirection by the ego. It is absolute nonsense. What Jesus did, the acts are so much more profound that these people who are coming on have no clue. They're absolutely clueless, actually. What I've seen in the world is everybody who's commenting in the popular, you know, mainstream, they're all completely ignorant. They're totally ignorant. They don't even know what they're talking about. It's blind leading the blind right now in this world. And we are in a situation where those who have wisdom are becoming non-entities, actually. Non-entities. So, what happened today was an attempt to redirect me back towards the flesh, back towards another cycle of existence. And I was able to sidestep it. But it was a very potent attempt to do that, to attract me back into the ego's plan of salvation, witches do, attract you. Now, what the ego wants to do is make the world seem attractive, make things seem attractive to you. It wants to attract you to things. That's why it uses models to attract you to the world, to things. Okay, it wants to create a consumer paradise. And this is very bad, very bad. Again, humans should not be involved in advertising at all. Actually, advertising should be banned, to tell you the truth. But definitely, the human form should not be used in advertising. That is very true. we are particularly susceptible to this. And when we are hit, love bombed, as it were, by the super attractive physical forms, this makes the world seem attractive, okay? It makes things. You're attracted, you become attracted to things. I want to buy this car. You know, it puts this glitter and glow, as it were, upon all things, and you want them. This is a very, very nasty trick of the ego. And then you develop a craving for the world, for impermanence. This training program, really, trying to train spirit how to die, is what existence is. So what happened today was, in a very unexpected way, I came across this embodiment of extreme beauty and attractiveness, and I was able to just ignore it and sidestep it, but it was a confrontation. It was just amazing how the ego rigged this up. And I was just like, wow, it was so unexpected. If I recount the story, people will say I'm making it up. No, it actually happened. And like I said, I met the devil today, really, because what is the devil? Is, if you want what the devil is, you would say supremely attractive, physically attractive person. But fleshy attractiveness, okay? Not spiritual attractiveness. It's different. The ego is trying to get you to say yes to things, to this externalization of matter, this projection, this dream, to say yes to the world. Yes, we can. Let's make it an attractive place. That's the ego. That's the Antichrist. The Holy Spirit and those who work for the Holy Spirit, who are aligned with the Holy Spirit, say, no, we can't. No, we can't learn how to die. So all this stuff is useless. We can't learn how to die. So this whole rigmarole of the world and existence, which is actually trying to train us to teach spirit how to die, is a complete waste of time. It's futile, it's useless, and it's not attractive. So no, we can't. So there's a different type of attractiveness. Those who have genuine, who are aligned with the Holy Spirit, you feel this attractiveness to know we cannot. And it's a spiritual attraction to this idea. Whereas those who are working for the ego, the Antichrist, you feel a fleshy attraction to the world, to this planet, to things, to all of this. And it's a very different attraction. So today, I was confronted with this incredibly beautiful, attractive, seductive form, human form. And which was attracting back to existence, back to another cycle, instead of getting out of the cycle. I was playing golf, actually. And I hit a ball on the 17th hole, hit a good drive, it's right in the middle. And I said, let me hit another one, just practice. And I sliced it. So I drove the golf course down, I'm looking for the ball, and I said, well, I'm going to try. There's a little part that goes around a bend, and there's a little bit of grass in that area. I said, maybe it hung up, and otherwise it went off the cliff, went down this arroyo, and it was gone. So I drove the cart around this corner, and there, standing right by my ball, was this person, female person. And I just came across in the golf cart, just boom, just so suddenly, like that, with a German Shepherd dog. And then she greeted me very, very forcefully. And I saw my ball. I said, "Oh," and then I just sort of picked up the ball, and then she said, "I'm going this way," and going back up the 17th, in other words, back on the course, back up, instead of finishing, going to another cycle, okay, going to another cycle. And fortunately, I didn't make eye contact. I didn't allow the psychic energy of this person to hit me. But this person had, I think, more psychic energy and of attractiveness than anyone I've ever seen on this planet. It was incredible. A young person, very young person, but powerful. And I was able to just, I didn't even look back or anything. I just was, whoa. I said, whoa, wow. That was unbelievable how that happened, you know. And I then what I did was I skipped the 18th hole. I said, forget it, you know, don't need it. And went to the driving range and practiced driving the ball, and I was just hit it incredibly well. I said, I don't want to slice it again. Don't go off toward into the woods like that. I mean, that, you know, don't veer off track like that. A super symbolic day, because the 18th hole, the sun was hitting directly in your eyes and you couldn't see anything. There was a big delay on the tee. I saw the delay, I saw the sun, I said I was tired, I said, forget it. I am just going home, going right now. So the whole thing was like this subtle spiritual play, as it were. And if you're in tune with the subtler aspects that take place, you will realize in your own life that there's, sometimes you're aware that there's this real subtle play going on that has great symbology and great meaning, actually. And this one had tremendous meaning, that I was able to not make any sort of connection with this entity. And it was a miracle that I did not. Because she was definitely trying to get my attention, focus on her and the situation, and then forget about going home. I mean, you know, finishing. And I was able to keep my focus, which is a miracle, absolute miracle. The Holy Spirit protected me, because I asked for protection. Before I went to the golf course, I said, I know I'm going to meet someone. I know that, because I was tipped off. I said, I'm going to meet this woman there. Somehow, someone's going to make a very determined, you know, attack on my attention. And son of a gun, if it didn't happen just like that, amazing. But I had already been buffered, already asked for the Holy Spirit for protection, and got the protection. But without that, without that, any of that protection, for sure, I would have been knocked off, what do we call it, knocked off track somehow. Just the attention would have gotten, you know, psychically off track. It's amazing how clever these psychic beings are, who are able to, you know, manipulate your psyche off track in some way like this. Yeah, just like, wow. Really scary stuff, actually. Very scary. It's interesting, the Germans, German Shepherd dog there, and German Shepherds, I've had quite a few German Shepherds, they're extremely loyal dogs. Germany was an incredibly pagan state for a long, 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 long time. The reason why Nazism, First World War, Second World War, the Germans were very warlike pagans, goddess worshippers. The Germans are tremendous goddess worshippers, as a matter of fact, throughout history. And they're very loyal to this, actually. Very loyal and easily led by a goddess figure, which is actually the embodiment of the Antichrist, trying to make the world seem attractive. Now, this being that I came across in such an unexpected way, because I hit a second drive, which I shouldn't have. I already hit a good one. Why should I hit a second one? And I said, wow, stupid. This being was definitely capable of making the world seem like it's very attractive. That was my impression. I didn't make any eye contact or anything like that, but it was just peripherally. I said, realize, wow, this is someone who could really make the world seem incredibly attractive. The whole world, everything in it. The food, the places, everything you're doing, it just make the world seem, oh, it's so wonderful. dangerous, dangerous person. You know, that's the last person. Here's a question. Ask yourself this. Would you rather have as your spiritual guru a very, very beautiful woman, super attractive, or would you rather have an ugly, ugly old man? You know, for me, he's the ugly old man, definitely. Because, but the only attraction they would have is the clarity and truth of what they're saying. If they're not saying truth and clear and effective, then there's no attraction at all, none. So you're protected. Whereas if you have a very beautiful woman, it doesn't really matter what she says. You say, well, it's all attractive anyway. You know, is that true? Well, it doesn't really matter that much. So very dangerous situation, actually. So give me an ugly, someone's ugly, definitely. and no physical attraction at all. That is the best. Because then you can, you know, you will tune in to what they say without all the glamour and all that kind of stuff. Weird stuff's happening. At church, there's a band, and very good band. There's a singer who's a very good singer, female singer. She's a super good singer. But she tries to draw the attention to herself, like as if, you know, we're a captive audience and we're supposed to be listening to her. And then last time she went and was going around, suddenly she was right there with us, and she introduced herself and her name and shook our hands and saying, I'm with the band, welcome, you know, to the church and all this kind of stuff. It's like, and she's been dressing up real fancy with ornamentation and everything, and it's like, wow, what's going on? You know, there's obviously here an attempt to make what's going on seem attractive, very attractive. Music, beautiful women singing, you know, very glorious type of, you know, types of singing. It's just very hip, and it's just like, oh, wow, that sounds great. This is very attractive coming to church. Interestingly enough, this is at a time when the church is actually being destroyed, in my opinion, by the Pope. The more and more the Pope seems like the anti-Pope, okay, and is undermining, you know, Christianity, in my opinion. So it's, you know, going to church is being less and less attractive, actually, because I say, wow, you know, I'm not, you know, what's being taught is compromise, which is the worst teaching possible, okay, it is the worst teaching possible. It is an attempt to serve both two masters. It is an attempt to appeal to everyone. Jesus said, if you teach the truth that he gave us, the world's going to hate you. Okay, but here we have the Pope trying to appeal to everybody. That's not Christianity. No, absolutely not. Christianity is not compromise. Okay, it is saying that there is a way to salvation, and it's a narrow way. And if you don't go through that narrow gate, you are going to continue on with very severe damnation, as a matter of fact, and that is true. So the purpose of Christians is to speak the unpopular, unpalatable truth to the pagans, and hope for repentance and conversion to the Holy Spirit's plan of salvation, which is the only plan that works. So you can't, you know, what's being uttered by this Pope is blasphemous. You know, really blasphemous. And of course, the pagans love it. They absolutely love it. You know, just celebrating, like they're throwing confetti in the air and saying, oh my God, finally we have our Pope, you know. Finally, the black Pope, you know, we finally have it. And they're feeling very emboldened now to attack Christians. Very emboldened. They say, wow, if the Pope says you guys are no good, then hey, we must be attacking you. Must be the right thing to do. So you have this incredible, so there's all this stuff going on in the world right now. And then you talk about the political spectrum, what's going on there, just amazing, amazing power grabs there. And it just doesn't stop anywhere, does it? It just doesn't stop. So, for me, I'm still standing because I keep asking the Holy Spirit for help. Had an incredible dream last night, incredible dream. Hard to explain, but there was these buildings. I saw all these buildings built up high and grandiose and all sorts of nice, beautiful buildings. And there was a door to the side of these buildings. There was a main entrance to the building, and on the side, a little like utility door or something. And out of this utility door came this little child. This is a child, like, I don't know, a four-year-old or something. It's petite, you know. Male or female, I assumed it was male, but you know, at that age, you know, it's sort of a genderless sort of being, not androgynous, but it's kind of just, you know, a little child. And the child started talking with me. And it was watching me brush my teeth. And it said to me, the child said, "Wow, you really brush your teeth really, really well. I like how you do that." And the child was some kind of expert on brushing your teeth and dental hygiene and something. And I said, "What are you going to be when you grow up?" And he said, "A dentist or something." And this child had this amazing certainty about itself, and you know, just like I was just amazed by this. It's just casual conversation, but the child seemed so poised and certain in a beautiful, just a childish way, and no, not pretentious or, you know, but just very calm and very straightforward. You know, just say, "Wow, what an amazing child this is." And then the child went back in the door and disappeared. And I was looking at this, all this house above, and I said, "You know, I want to talk to this child again. What's going on with this? What's going on here? This is something that's interesting." So I kind of called through the door. There's a little crack in the door there, and just a little bit of the door had been worn away, sort of. So there's a little air spacing. I said, hey, are you there, child? Are you there?" And I heard a voice saying, "Who is that? Who is it?" And I said, "It's Ross." You know, and I said, "Oh, great. Okay, I'll be right with you." You know, it's like they're very happy to hear from me. Like they really liked me. This little child really liked me. There's something about me that this child really liked. I don't know what's brushing my teeth, but that's a kind of a symbolic thing of. Keeping your mouth super clean and straight, and everything, all the plaque is gone, etc. Because out of your mouth comes what? Words, right? So this child was super keen on the cleanliness of the mouth, as it were, and was an expert. I mean, the child presented himself as an expert, which was quite, you know, amazing. I didn't laugh. I just said, "Wow, a child, this little child is coming across as some kind of supreme expert." So again, I called out the child, and then I got this feeling, you know what? I'd like to go see where the child lives. I mean, it seems to live underneath all these big homes, like in a down below somewhere. But I got the feeling that the child's living quarters looked out upon this beautiful, beautiful place somehow, and that it's the houses built on top of this. Those are the ones that just look out on this crummy world. That somehow this child was dwelling in a dwelling place that was incredibly beautiful. That's my impression. So who was this child? You know, who was this child? It was probably the Christ child, actually. And that's why they're such supreme expert and just matter-of-fact expert saying, you know, "I want you to brush your teeth." And I was brushing my teeth and said, "Wow, that's very, very good job you're doing there brushing your teeth." He's watching very intently how I brush my teeth and everything. And so I said, "You know what, I wanna visit with this and talk again. What's going on? This is something very interesting." So here we have with our external reality, I think all those homes represented the external reality of the planet, and underneath that is this spiritual realm, the spiritual realm, kingdom of heaven, as it were. This is the world is like superimposed on top of it. And so this child was dwelling in the spiritual realm, actually, that we don't recognize. So, you know, because the child was just so poised and calm and peaceful and perfectly symmetrical and poised, you know, their features and everything was just like perfect. And they seemed so, I said, how could they be living in a terrible place? They must be. Well, their dwelling place must be, you know, just amazing, actually. So, there you go, meeting the Christ child. And again, I said, "Hey, you there? Who's that?" "Oh, yeah. Oh, great, great, great. Yeah, I wanna talk to you. Just 1 second, I'll be right there." So they were like, I feel like they were like getting something ready real quick, and then you know, oh, they're guy, hi, they're gonna say hello. It's interesting that Ananda and my ma always insisted that she was just a little child. And all this people puffing her up to be some great goddess, or she said, no. I'm just a little child, just a child. Just a child. Look at me as just a child who really doesn't know anything more than just the, you know, than this little child. That's it. Just that is the truth of the situation. So this little child that I was visiting with was why little child? Because little child has not grown into the flesh yet. So in other words, it symbolizes very much disinterest in the flesh, has not accumulated, you know, the fleshiness, has not accumulated the interest and attractiveness of the flesh and all of that. That's what it indicates. I mean, the child was skinny, small, skinny. I didn't feel any fleshiness about this child at all, not at all. It was just pure intelligence, you know, and knowingness, just pure knowingness. They just seemed to have this knowingness. This child just knew what it knew. And it was looking at me and just said, "I know, you know, you're doing a great job brushing your teeth." It just knew that. And I was thinking, how does it know that? And what, who judges, you know, who can judge how people brush their teeth, whether it's the right way or whatnot? It's very funny. But I think it's a symbolic thing, again, brushing your teeth. So right in the midst of our prosaic lives, where we just go about every day and it seems like such a blah, why am I doing this and this and this and that, there is this incredible drama taking place within, where we're trying to shed our attraction to the external, impermanent dance of formations that we call existence, but was actually a training program that the mind is hallucinating for us. They're supposed to teach us how to die. And remember, the mind is only doing this because we told the mind we want to be prime creator. See, the mind is not a villain at all, but it's playing the role of a villain. But don't fall for that trick. It's not a villain at all. And we cannot kill the mind, the true mind, capital mind, because the mind is part of reality. It's the presenter of ideas. It's the producer. You have an idea, mind produces the idea so you can experience it. In this case, the mind is producing this training program that supposedly is supposed to teach us how to die, spiritual death, so we can then be prime creator, be resurrected as prime creator. It's never going to happen. Can't happen. So it's all a waste of time. But we should not, you know, don't, what we have to do is not try to kill the mind, but choose a new idea. Give the mind a new idea. Or let the whole, actually the Holy Spirit is the new idea. That God stepped in and said, okay, here's a new idea, it's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is a new idea. And so we need to listen and accept the activity, the grace of God, so to speak, is the new idea. And then the mind will present to us, you know, this new idea, this I call it perfect stalemate, the perfect no, the perfect stalemate, etc. All of this is on our plate. So we're capable of meeting the Christ child, actually. We're capable of meeting. And in last night, in my dreams, I believe most definitely I met the Christ child. I had previously, long ago, too. But this time it was different. It was much more casual, friendly, a meeting. You know, and the interaction was very much acceptable and not overwhelming, anything like that. It was just kind of a matter of fact, pragmatic type of congenial type of meeting. You know, that's all it was. It's just like, but I got the impression, like, this child knows. It knows that it knows. doesn't need the flesh. It only appears a little child for our sake, really. But this knowing doesn't need the flesh to know. The knowing knows. Doesn't need any flesh, okay? But for our sake, it will appear as a little child. And Jesus said, and a little child shall lead them. Or you must be like a little child to enter the kingdom of heaven, so to speak. That's symbolically speaking. You drop the attraction to the flesh, as it were. So this entity, this person I met, that I didn't meet, but I was accosted by, actually, in a very seemingly innocent way, but I was accosted. I didn't say anything. I didn't say a word, but I was accosted, actually. This being said, hi, hello, like that. I was like trying to, be real sweet and nice and attractive and hi, congenial, but I didn't say anything. Just kind of, oh, there's my ball. I think I'm going to get my golf ball and just get out of here, That is the flesh doing that, okay? That's the flesh that's caused. The Christ child doesn't accost us in that way. Not at all. Does not appeal to the flesh at all. Not in the slightest bit. Which is why I think most people overlook, the Christ child. And the Christ child was actually overjoyed that I had called for it again. I wanted another meeting. He said, wow, you're back? You want to talk to me? That's great. They're very happy about that. This child is very happy. I could tell. I was like, oh, wow, I like this guy. Yeah, I want to talk with you again. Absolutely. And that's the energy, sir. Yeah. Very, what do you call that the attitude? Really great attitude, I would say. And not based on the flesh at all. Not based on the flesh. Whereas the Zenny I met today, 100% based on the flesh. 100%. 100%. And of course the world has been misled by many, 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 many types of this fleshy attractiveness in the world that has constantly been poured out upon us over the last 100 years. Advertising everything, trying to attract us to this world, to this planet. And it continues on and on and on and on. And that's a very wicked thing, actually. Because it's attracting us to death, trying to keep us attracted to death. As I say, this world is now populated by necrophiliacs, actually. The only people that aren't are people of various faiths and determination. Maybe agnostics, too, who are not aligned with any particular faith, but who are determined to, break this, get out of the cycles of existence. Those are the only ones who are not necrophiliacs and not attracted to death. I mean, death can take on some very, very attractive form. What I saw today was a very attractive form of death, extremely so. You just take all of the stereotypes of beauty and attractiveness and just put them all into one person. There was. So what's just attraction to death is all was, just attraction to death, but death will present itself very attractively. And if you start to get hip to this, you see out in the world, you see people and how they present themselves, and you realize that's just death, and you say, how can these people be so stupid? How can you fall for that? How can you fall for that beautiful facade, as it were? And yet they do. They do. Of course, a lot of them are, drinking, taking drugs and drinking. That always, that's another problem. Drinking and drugs make the flesh look attractive, way more attractive than it really is, which is why, and fantasy, mental fantasy, okay. Those three are no-no. And pornography, all of that stuff, drinking, drugs, pornography, fantasy, and beautiful clothes and all that stuff. Those are big, big taboos, actually. Huge taboos in the responsible society. And also I would add meat and certainly stimulants like caffeine. Definitely. Caffeine is an incredible aphrodisiac, actually. It makes the flesh look way more attractive than you would ordinarily see it. Way more. Absolutely. So I consider it a very strong drug, caffeine, actually. So, you know, for me, that the great gurus tell us those are no-nos. No, very animal products also attract us to the flesh. No meat, no stimulants, no drugs, no alcohol, no pornography, no mental fantasizing about romantic and pornographic situations, all that stuff. None of that, and no, you know, really attractive, fashionable type of clothes, all that stuff. Prohibited. Actually, there have been throughout history most times sumptuary laws, which are laws about how you dress and appear in public. And those have completely disappeared, which is just insane, totally insane. I mean, you couldn't imagine a more egoic, antichrist situation than to do away with all sumptuary laws. That's why, like in Catholic schools, they have uniforms, you know, and which is, you know, very good idea. But you go around now in public and see the way people are dressed, and you just like say, wow, it's just crazy. These people are definitely doing everything they can to attract themselves to the flesh, to the creature, to the animal nature, to death, as a matter of fact. They don't quite realize they're attracting themselves to death. They know, because of the fear of the continuity issue, that they prefer death to eternal disorientation, really, is what the continuity issue, the leverage it has, is it seems like eternal disorientation. So people say, oh, I'd much rather die than be eternally disoriented. For sure. I mean, who wouldn't? Eternal disorientation, having experienced a moment of it, is the worst thing possible. And you beg for death compared to that. So it is not at all surprising that people are super attracted to death, because they think their options are either eternal disorientation or death. That's the options the ego presents to you. But the Holy Spirit is a third option. Okay, it's another option, and this is what people don't understand. They don't get that, and so they keep on desperately, you know, digging their talons into the rotting flesh of existence. And existence keeps presenting itself and marketing itself as this super desirable, beautiful, attractive, you know, thing that you can, you know, get a hold of. Of course, when you get a hold of it, you realize it's all rotting. It's all rotten. It is. The beautiful tomatoes on the vine, they're all rotting right now. Turn into just, you know, yucky stuff, throwing out vegetables. Everything molds, it rots. You know, yeah. That's not attractive. It's not attractive at all. And yet, nobody seems to get it, because they think the alternative is eternal disorientation. So of course they keep on soldiering on. Of course everybody soldiers on. If you don't see the continuity problem as the ego presents it as bogus, and that the Holy Spirit has solved it, then you're going to soldier on for sure. You are going to soldier on with death as your companion. And you're going to try to make it as attractive as possible. Of course you will. Of course everyone will. And you're going, and as that has gained momentum in the world now, the ego is poised to crush, you know, those who are inclined toward the Holy Spirit. It's really poised to crush them, and is really crushing them right as we speak. Actually, the mill is pulverizing the grain, as it were. We were warned about these times, in the Bible warned about these times, the end times, or the end of the cycle, saying that an evil and adulterous generation that follows the Antichrist will arise in this world and will do everything they can to lead everybody to ruination, damnation. In other words, turn them away from the Holy Spirit, turn them away from truth. And that will be so severe that even the elect of God will be in danger of being turned away into another cycle of existence. And that's exactly what almost happened to me today. That didn't happen, but there was an extreme attempt to do so today. I said, look, this is scary, very scary, very, very scary. And it's the younger generation, this younger generation. We've had four generations now of hardcore ego, egoic upbringings with a full flood of the commercialism, you know, in the you know, starting in the swinging 60s, as it were. You had the baby boomers, their children, and their children, now they're even more. It's just, it's compiled itself with the pop culture and everything we have going, the ego has going for it, that it's now created this younger generation of people that can be incredibly seductive in terms of their physicality and attractiveness towards the flesh, towards the world, because they're all in. And that gives sort of this psychic power to them, actually. They have the psychic power because they're so aligned with it. You know, they seem so accepting of this. Where in the past, no. You don't do that. You don't idolize yourself, how you look. And, you know, but now they have all these people are raised with all these beauty aids, and they're just brought up, you know, as you know, princes and princesses. Feeling that they're, you know, gods and goddesses, actually, and they don't question it. See, that's the scary thing. They think, no, I am the goddess. They say, yeah, they've completely accepted in their own psyche that I am the goddess. I am a goddess. And it's their entire belief system. So that belief system is a powerful psychic kind of force, actually, that makes them seem very attractive, okay? Very dangerous, actually, exceedingly dangerous. So, we're at that time now, and there's no question about it, no question about it. So, it is the younger generation that has this psychic coherence about them in terms of their own egotistical nature. They're all in with the ego. They've gone all in. Previous generations, no way. The people are completely different. They weren't nearly as attractive. Because in their minds they're saying, I don't think that's a very smart thing to do. That's trouble. I think I've been taught that no, let's go easy on all this stuff. Well, you know, let's back away. And no, the people didn't look anything remotely as attractive as they are now. I went to a Giants game, San Francisco Giants game, the AT&T Park, and I just strolling around, just looking at the whole scene. It's just like incredible. And the people were so, you know, dressed up and dolled up, and you know, everybody looked like actors and actresses, actually. And I noticed the women copied these actresses, okay, and their makeup, their hair, the way they look, the style, everything. And they present themselves as these super sophisticated, incredibly, you know, physically together, you know, entities. It's just like, they're just like, you know, incredible. They think of themselves as stars and starlets, and that they're incredible. You know, they're incredibly beautiful. Just everybody is simply, you know, has to be captivated by them. There's no question about it in their minds. And that's where we're at, where this is now completely normal. Whereas in the past, you simply didn't have it. Even the great actresses in the back in the past, they didn't have it anywhere close to the charisma of just an ordinary person now at a baseball game. Who has this attitude that they're incredibly captivating, you know, and everybody's reinforcing that, like, oh, wow, you're so captivating. Oh, yeah, so are you. Oh, my gosh. Tweet, 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 you know, text them, send pictures, you know, social networking, all that stuff. Oh, you're so incredible. You're so incredible. You see this on the social networks, like everybody saying, like, oh, you're so beautiful. You're incredibly beautiful. Oh, you're so wonderful. You're so incredible. And they're just reinforcing this egoic attitude that they're super captivating, and it's become so entrenched now in the psyche of the world that there are people now who don't even think about it. They say, I just know I'm super captivating, and that is the super danger, and that's what I was protected from. I had to ask the Holy Spirit. I said, Holy Spirit, I know someone is going to put a extreme attack on me today, and you've got to protect me from it, because this, you know, don't want to fail this one. And I was protected somehow, amazingly. But this person just knew that they were totally captivating. Yeah, just knew it. And just radiated this out, you know, like a goddess. So we've brought up a generation of goddesses and gods, as it were. in this world, but goddesses and gods of the flesh, of the ego, of the Antichrist, of Satan, of the devil. That's actually what they serve. They serve to attract us to another cycle of trying to learn to love death. Okay, trying to learn to love death and ultimately our own death, and hoping if we love death enough, we will finally die. So this whole love thing has been twisted around. What Jesus talked about was agape, not the kind of love of being captivated. No. Not at all. Love of truth is what Jesus taught. Love of God, who is spirit, of reality, love of the Holy Spirit, love of truth, and supporting one another in that endeavor. That's the love of God Jesus is talking about. But it's been twisted around and into love of one another as flesh, you see. That's how it's been twisted around. So the ego says, you can learn to love the world, which is death. You can learn to love death, as it were. It's a training program of death. You can learn to love it. No, you can't. And the Holy Spirit says, no, you can't. You cannot. And so that no, you can't protected me today. The Holy Spirit just was right there with me saying, hey, no, you can't. You can't learn to love this. You can't learn to love the world because it's death. You can't die. And you can't love what's impossible, what can never happen. There's nothing there to love. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. There is no such thing as spiritual death, so how can you love it? It's impossible. So all praise and thanks to the Holy Spirit, but these times are really too much. Rarely do I skip the 18th hole like that, but it was a no-brainer for me. I just decided, you know what, that's it. That's it. I'm going home right now. No more delay. I wasn't going to sit around waiting for 15 minutes on the tee with that sun blasting me right in the face. I couldn't even see my tee shot. If I hit it, it would be a blind shot. And it's all the struggle. Forget it. It's not worth it. So we can leave this cycle of existence. We can leave cycles of existence right now. Right now, we don't have to continue on through the tribulation period, actually. For me, it's pre-trib, most definitely. Most definitely. I think people can stay if they want, mid-trib, post-trib, as it were. But the tribulation period is most certainly upon us. And we can just say, forget this. This little period, you know, this 18th, I'll forget it. Don't need it. I don't need it. Go to the driving range, meaning go to a retreat, okay, and iron out your difficulties, which I did. Went to the driving range, and I was absolutely just crushing it. Just crushing it. Just unbelievably well. Shot after shot after shot. Just carbon copy. You know, it was perfect. And then I just, okay. I don't even use range balls. I find balls during my round of golf, good golf balls, but not the type that I use, the best ones. And I say, I'm not going to use these anyway, so I just bring them to the range, you know, really good golf balls, and I just hit them. Instead of hitting the range balls, the old crummy balls, I hit the really good ones. But I only hit five, and it, you know, it's perfect. I say, okay, forget it. I just leave. That's it. Don't need any more. Got it. Absolutely had it. So when you go into retreat from the tribulation times, you will crystallize and clarify and work out and get it just right, and you'll say, you'll say, okay, I know exactly what's going on. I know exactly what I need to do. I know exactly the inner life. I've got it straight. I'm brushing my teeth perfectly. No worry, and no more slicing the golf ball. As it were. Well, occasionally, you know, it might happen, but no. I should be able to not do it. And then once that happens, like, you get your confidence back. And the ego's lost its grip, it's lost its hold on you, you know. That's the way to do it right now. Skip the tribulation. Go into spiritual sanctuary refuge. You'll be able to settle yourself down. And you'll realize, wow, I really can. I really do have it very clear. I really can brush my teeth just the right way. Get used to the Christ child, okay? Make friends with the Christ child. Just make friends. The Christ child will show you its abode, his wondrous abode. My feeling is that the Christ child is dwelling in some incredibly beautiful abode. And you just make friends with it, which is what I did in that dream. We're friends. We're friends. That's all. Just friends. You can't really worship this little child, no, because it doesn't come off like that. It just doesn't work. It's just friends. You're friends. And the little child seems to be in a very humble position in relation to you. And is perfectly happy with that, you see. But you're just friends. So these are the days of our lives right now where incredible stuff is happening. And incredible opportunity is here. And don't doubt this for a minute. But the world is so intensely now against all of this that it's going down the drain. It's like someone flushed the toilet and it's just going down the drain, whoosh, like that. So you keep your poise, keep your prayers going. And this is just reassurance for those who are the elect of God, really, meaning those who've elected to exchange this training program for another training program, actually, for the perfect no, to get used to the perfect no. The elect of God means those who decide to go back home. Stop this silly training program. Stop trying to learn how to die and have the continuity problem solved. Accept the solution to the continuity problem. Get used to it, and then you will return home. Those are called the elect of God. So these videos are for the elect of God, those who have elected to go home. And these videos serve as reassurance. I'm reassuring you. The Christ child lives, absolutely. I had an interaction with it in a dream just last night. It's there. It's within everyone. It's within you. It's within me. You can talk with the Christ child and listen. Listen. And make friends with it. And then it might say, hey, you want to see my room, my place? Say, sure, I'll take a look. And then, you know, see the light, see the beauty, see something truly wondrous. All this is possible. We don't have to fall for what the ego is doing to us, which is our attraction to it is the fear of the continuity issue, always. We'd rather pursue death than feel eternally disoriented. So what we do is we try to find attractive forms of death, very attractive forms of death, which then overcomes our distaste of it. Because really, the flesh is just this rotting bag of pus, really. But, you know, we dress it up and try to, you know, put lipstick on the pig and try to make it look as attractive as possible because we think the alternative is so terrible. We're just driven to keep on embracing this rotting corpse that we call existence. But we don't have to keep doing that because the Holy Spirit has solved the continuity problem. So there's no problem now. There's really no problem whatsoever. The perfect no is already there. It's already there. So just hang in there, which is what I've been doing. I've been under terrible troubles, but just hanging in there and keeping a sort of a bemused sense of humor about it all, how pathetic the ego really is in the big final analysis, and how this is just a complete waste of time, and that, you know, you will prevail. You will choose correctly. You will make the right choice and stay on track. Just keep your sense of humor. Don't get too serious. Don't make too severe of efforts, actually. Because we should kind of have a little more relaxed effort to it. Easy on things. You know, when you make, in putting, I would, you know, grip the putter very lightly, and just relax a little bit. Don't grind too much. Keep a sense of humor, but also alertness, and make sure that you're protected by the perfect know of the Holy Spirit will protect you during these times, and we will stay tuned for what is next. All right, very great. That's it for this one.